I love our worship experience. We were worshiping from home today, and so it was a delight to peek into each person's home and to join our hearts together. And so it's a great experience. Well, I hope you had a great week and you dug yourself out of the snow, if you were saddled with that on the East Coast where I am. And so I had over 30 inches of snow, and so it was a lot of snow, enough. But I'm ready for the word, and I want to pray with you and invite you to join me in prayer. So would you bow your heart right where you are, please? Father, over these next moments, as we open up sacred scripture, I pray that the power of the Holy Spirit will go to work in each of our hearts, change us together. I ask you these things in the wonderful name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. I want to begin a brand new 3-week teaching series on the theme of character and integrity. My topic today is character matters. We're living in a day and age where we hear very little about character and the benefits of having a strong, solid, morally based character. It's almost like a fleeting thought. In fact, it seems elusive. One person anonymously said, "Everyone tries to define this thing called character. It's not hard. Character is doing what's right when nobody's looking." Let me ask you this question. What doors would open wide for you in your vocation, in your career, in your schooling, in strategic relationships, if you spent this year honing and developing your character? David, king of Israel, second king, he said this in Psalm 15 and verse 1. "God, who gets invited to dinner at your place? How do we get on the guest list? Walk straight, act right, tell the truth." That's the answer. In other words, there are huge benefits to having a godly character. And David just highlighted the idea that God invites us into his place and builds relationships with us because God is holy and he looks to establish a growing relationship with people who also want to grow in holiness. Now, I'm going to ask you to make a commitment to me and together. Would you make a commitment over the next 3 weeks to walk with me through this series and not miss one of them so that we can grow together in our character? And so at the end of 3 weeks, you would have seen an uptick in your development of your character just by walking with me through this series. If you will make that commitment, type yes in the comment section or give a thumbs up emoji, and then I'll know we're together. Thank you for doing that. I appreciate that. I'm with you. Let's grow together. Now, let's frame the question. What are some practical things that we can do to grow in our character, to develop character? I believe if we ask ourselves three very simple questions, we're going to find ourselves moving in the greater direction that moves to and yields godliness and good, solid character. The first question I pose is, who am I? I must ask myself that question. You must ask yourself that question. And that question, it really is tied to your identity. Who are you on a deep cellular level? Because I believe when I recognize who I am, it drives the way I behave. It drives the way I act. It drives my attitude. And so I must ask that question. The Apostle Paul, he points this out to us in 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. Paul says, "Anyone who belongs to Christ is a new person. The past is forgotten and everything is new." Paul is telling us that when you accept Christ as your Savior, you actually become a brand new person. You actually change in who you are, in your identity. You become not just the old with some kind of varnish over you or stain or paint over you. No, You change on the inside on a cellular level. And so the New Testament scholar Philip Hughes says, when he refers to the old things are passed away and the new has become, Philip Hughes says that the old represents distinctions, prejudices, misconceptions, enslavements, a former unregenerate life. Those things assume the character of pastness. They're no longer there. In fact, the scripture, when it uses the word, Paul says, all have become new. New is in the technical grammar, it means present tense. It's that type of speech which says that the old things became new and they continue to be new. It's not like when you bought a sofa, everybody says, where'd you get that sofa? Oh, I bought it at the store, brand new sofa. What the new life is not you having a new experience. It's you becoming a new person, and you keep on in that newness throughout your entire spiritual life. I want you to see it takes place when you accept Christ as your Savior. Have you accepted Christ as your Savior? If you have not, all the good habits and good practices, it's almost like me tying fruit on a tree. I tie an apple on there, I tie an orange on there, I tie a grapefruit on there. Fruit doesn't get born that way. It doesn't grow that way. It grows from what's on the inside. If you want the fruit of a godly character, it takes place in your identity. You have to identify with the one who is in charge of all characters, God Himself. There's this movie that Hollywood put out to Walt Disney. And the movie's called The Lion King. And in The Lion King, there was a lot of typology that really captures the relationship that we have with God the Father. And in The Lion King, it features the main character as a little lion cub named Simba. His dad, the king of the jungle is the lion, his dad passed away, and Simba's growing. And one day, Simba gets to the place where he has to ask himself this question as to, who am I? And I want you to understand this.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
Look inside yourself, Simba. You are more than what you have become. You must take your place in the circle of life.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please. Don't leave me.
Remember.
Father.
Remember.
Don't leave me.
Remember.
I mean, what a wonderful picture of the biblical parallel. When you accept Christ as Savior, your identity changes. The old person is gone. The new person has come. And what happens is that on a cellular level, you're changed. That's what drives my behavior and my quest to become more Christ-like and to be like my Father, my Heavenly Father. The idea is that when you look in the mirror, you're supposed to see Jesus. because we become like Christ daily, more and more like Him. And so I want us to recognize that. Now, when we think about DNA, which is the deoxyribonucleic acid, that's not what I mean. I mean your deeds, your nature, and your affections. When you accept Christ, it now on a cellular level calls you to be godly. You don't have to strive for it and work hard in terms of saying, what do I do? It's in you. It just needs to come out. And so over these next several weeks, as we delve into character, I want you to know that on a cellular level, your deeds, your nature, and your affection, your DNA says you can be godly. Paul tells us in Romans 6, verse 6, "For we know that our old self was crucified with Him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin." I want you to see you're no longer what you used to be. And if you've never prayed to accept Christ as your Savior, I want to pray with you at the end of my teaching time, because I want you to experience this brand new life that Jesus says is yours. And when you experience that life, you have the necessary DNA, the cellular structure, to be able to live in a way that's morally upright and strong, godly character. Why? It comes from within and not from without. And so I want you to recognize that very thing. So we must ask ourselves this foundational question in character development: who am I? And then we must ask ourselves, who am I becoming? Paul speaks to this. He lets us know that we're changing. We're going through a process, an ongoing metamorphosis. Every day we're becoming more and more like Jesus. He tells then the church at Ephesus, he spends a great deal of time helping to shape and hone the character of each individual that was worshiping at the church at Ephesus. In fact, in Ephesians 4 and verse 17, Paul begins by saying, "As a follower of the Lord, I order you to stop living like stupid, godless people. Their minds are in the dark, and they are stubborn and ignorant, and have missed out on the life that comes from God. They no longer have any feelings about what is right, and they're so greedy that they do all kinds of indecent things. But that isn't what you were taught about Jesus Christ. He is the truth, and you heard about Him and learned about Him." I want you to recognize what Paul is saying. He's telling us that there should be a stark difference between your character and those who don't know Christ. It's very real. Paul says, look, when they don't have the wellspring of life inside of them, causing them to strive to be more like Christ and to live in a way that reflects God and godliness, all kinds of crazy, zany things they'll do, and they'll think it's right. I mean, it's bizarre. I mean, I've read articles about restaurants in England and in France, in Japan, that they only accept people that come there, patrons, who are naked. You go off into a room, take off your clothes, and then you can get a seat. And when the restaurant opened up in London, it had 16,000 people signed up for a reservation. You tell me if that makes sense. Now, it closed in a couple of months, but there's still other restaurants in other countries trying to do the same thing, because when you don't have a moral compass based on something that is inflexible and unmoving, God is that anchor point to morality. When you don't have that, all kinds of things you say, good is bad and bad is good, and you just waffle back and forth because nothing is there as an anchor point. What we're learning is this: the question you must ask yourself is, who am I becoming? And so your life then must be able to reflect your beliefs. Who am I becoming financially in terms of my values? Who am I becoming in terms of my relationships? Are they healthy? Does it matter to me? Who am I becoming in my mental health? Who am I becoming in the way, in my sexuality? What am I becoming? And so these questions, probative questions that seem complex on the surface, they're really challenging me at the core, philosophically and theologically, to say, David, go through some self-examination. Check out what you're doing and what you're saying and how you're thinking. Is what you're doing matching up? And so I always ask myself this question, what would Jesus do? In fact, it was about 4 months after I came to Christ. I led this young lady, we worked together in a water treatment laboratory in grad school. And I led her to Christ. And she was married. And so I met her husband. I led him to Christ. And so I was overjoyed. So here I am now, just a young Christian, you know, a couple of months old in my faith. And one day in the lab, the lady tells me, let's call her name Mary. Mary says to me, hey, David, you wouldn't believe what happened yesterday to my husband. I said, what happened? She said, he won $200 at the racetrack. God blessed him. Now, I'm just 6 months old in the Lord. I have no great big mass of theology and biblical knowledge. I've not read through the Bible, not even once, not even halfway through. I'm a neophyte. I'm a beginner. I'm an upstart. I'm a babe in Christ. But I did know somehow that didn't ring true as an example of moral rightness. And the only thing I can say to her is, I don't see that Jesus would do that. I said, can you see Jesus standing next to your husband at the racetrack saying, go lucky eight, go lucky eight? I couldn't see it. We laughed together, and that probing question, who am I becoming, when we go through self-examination, asking ourselves the question, what would Jesus do? It helps us to make a quick shift, quick adjustments, and align our life or our attitude with what we believe Jesus would do based on the teaching of Scripture. Self-examination is so important. Self-regulation is also important. Self-regulation is a step after self-examination. Self-examination says, I'm holding up my life to the mirror of God's Word. And the Word is not wrong. It's when my life doesn't align with the Word, the values of the Word, the behavior of the Word, the attitude of the Word calls me to subscribe to, when my life is not aligned with that, I must then, that's the self-examination part. The self-regulation part is when I make adjustments. Now, granted, there's some things I don't know how to adjust. That's why I depend on the Holy Spirit. There's some things I don't know how to make that change, even though I know I need to make that change. That's why I depend on the Holy Spirit. Benjamin Franklin, in his book, The Autobiography of Benjamin Franklin, he set out at one time in his life to really work on his morality and his character. And he said he went for days to make sure he had virtues like generosity and honesty. And one virtue he was really working at was humility. And he wrote and said, I noticed that for 3 days straight, I was so humble and I took pride in my humility. And then he realized, how could you be haughty about being humble? How could you be proud that you were humble for the past 3 days? Therein lies the conundrum. That's why we can't, in our own strength, regulate every aspect of our behavior. There must be a dependence on the Holy Spirit. And I want to invite you in this journey. As we're growing in our relationship with Christ, I want you to go through self-examination and self-regulation by asking the question, what am I becoming? Who am I becoming? It's very, very important. Booker T. Washington, the first president of Tuskegee Institute, he used to have Sunday evening meetings with his students and any professors that would like to come over to his home as he talked about character. Every Sunday evening was a little presentation he would give on the benefits of character and how do you hone and develop your character. You know, what Booker T. Washington recognizes this, education alone is not going to help make the whole person. And you may be very educated. I commend you. You have your undergraduate. You have several masters. You may even have a terminal degree, a PhD or an EdD. Thank you for being educated, but just because you're educated doesn't mean that you have a godly character. And that's why I want to invite you to grow in godliness. You got to ask yourself the question, who am I? Who am I becoming? And then you ask yourself this final question, who do I want to be? This question is very important. Warren Buffett said, business tycoon and philanthropist, he said, in looking for people to hire, you look for three qualities, integrity, intelligence, and energy. And if you don't have the first, the other two will kill you. Oh, how I agree with him. And so we ask the question, who do I want to be? The Apostle Paul continues his teaching to the church at Ephesus when he says in verse 22 of Ephesians 4, you were told that your foolish desires will destroy you and that you must give up your old way of life with all its bad habits. Let the Spirit change your way of thinking and make you into a new person. You were created to be like God, and so you must please Him and be truly holy. Paul is saying that you have, I have, we have the capability to work on our character. It's not magical. It's not something that, oh, I hope I grow in my character. It's not a hope-based phenomena. This is something that you intentionally, devotedly, strategically do. I remember in the early days of ministry, I made a vow to myself. Now, I've been pastoring now for 34 years, almost 35. I started when I was 24. And I remember, there I was as a young man, I remember saying to myself, I am going to make a commitment to you, God, that I'll never carry myself based on dress, attire, jewelry, or those any of those external symbols that'll cause people to trip up when they hear me speak. I'm going to carry myself as someone that is easily invited into people's lives based on my character. And so I began to work on my character. I'm still doing that even now more and more because I ask myself the question, who do you want to be? And that question is important. Paul says, here's how you do it intentionally. You get rid of the old habits. Get rid of the old lifestyle. Don't sit there and salivate over what you used to be and how you used to do what you did. Don't smile about it. It's not joyous. It speaks of your broken state. Don't gloat about it. Paul says, those foolish desires, don't idolize. Throw them to the wayside. Dismiss them. And so I want us to recognize that. And when we think about who do I want to be, I must have examples, models to me. I hold up certainly Jesus as the preeminent model. And Paul's one of my guys. I just love the Apostle Paul. But then there must be earthly models. And they can't be the Hollywood people. It can't be major athletes, famous athletes. We can't look at them and wealthy individuals per se to let that be our role model. Because if that's the case, you're going to be watching shows like Keeping Up with the Kardashians and Real Housewives of Beverly Hills or Housewives of Atlanta or, God forbid, RuPaul's Drag Race. And then you're sitting there plopping down in front of the TV and you're just sitting there just looking at them and being fascinated by them. You can't be lured into that. Don't let that be your role models, or don't let that be the place where you relax. Because if you relax in front of that, unbeknownst to you, unconsciously, it goes in. And when it sinks in, it'll come out. And so I want you to recognize Paul is saying, you got to fuel the new life with new desires and new habits so that the new you will be evident to all. He tells us in verse 23, let the Spirit change your way of thinking and make you into a new person. You were created to be like God, and so you must please Him and be truly holy. So what I have in front of me, which I invite you to do as well, the question, who do I want to be? I want to be like my Father in my character, my Heavenly Father. And it's challenging, yes, but it's not condemning. It's inviting. It's not overwhelming. And the beauty about this is that Jesus walks with you. He doesn't leave you isolated, and He doesn't put a gun over your head. He invites you into this journey daily that you become more and more like Christ. And it's an ongoing process. You were changed. You are changed. You will be changed. This progressive process, or sanctification is the fancy $10 theological term. I'm just framing it around character development. We're constantly being changed. Let me tell you, I remember a second person I led to Christ, or perhaps the third person I led to Christ. Again, I was a new Christian, maybe about 8 months old in my faith. I led this other engineering student to Christ. I was so overjoyed. And then I took it upon myself to try to mentor him. I can't even spell the word mentor. I'm 21 years old at the time, and I'm going to disciple him and help him grow in Jesus. I'm just 8 months old in my faith. I don't know the basics myself. And I remember I was on the campus of Stevens Institute of Technology. I was a graduate student there. And I went over to my friend's dorm, knocked on the door. Bill answered. And when he answered, this was a January now, frigid outside, freezing. I'd bundle up with layers of coats, gloves on, hat on, scarf, all that just to walk through the snow to get to his dorm. I got there because we're going to read the Bible together, and I'm going to answer some of his questions, and we're going to learn together. And so I took it upon myself. I'm going to be his Bible teacher, at least to mentor him. When I get there, he opens the door, and he has no shirt on. He has on shorts. He didn't just come from the gym. No socks, no shoes, nothing. So he just has his shorts. The window's open. It's freezing in his room. And so I said, Bill, what are you doing? He said, David, last time we talked about walking in holiness and crucifying the flesh, I'm just crucifying the flesh. I just need to speed things up. I said, it doesn't work that way. Now, I didn't know any better, but I just knew if that's the reason why I knew it didn't work that way, because I had tried it. I mean, it doesn't work that way. But I want you to see, I said, put on your clothes, man. Close the window. It's cold in here. That's not how character is honed and developed. It starts on the inside and works on the outside over time. But you have to then look at it as you're becoming more and more like Jesus. You're yielding more and more to your Heavenly Father's promptings and invitations and wooing and adjustments so you can become like Christ. I love what Oswald Chambers, author and Bible teacher, once said. The expression of Christian character is not good doing, but God-likeness. If the Spirit of God has transformed you within, you will exhibit divine characteristics in your life, not good human characteristics. God's life in us expresses itself as God's life, not as human life trying to be godly. How true. Let's make a commitment over these next 3 weeks as we learn about character development together that you will then yield yourself to the Spirit of God so you're not adding stuff on you like that tree I alluded to. You tie on a grapefruit, or you tie on an orange, or you tie on an apple. No, you're allowing the fruit to be born from the inside out. And when people see your lives and see your life, they see God-likeness in you. Now remember, I mentioned my teaching. To be able to answer the question, who am I? Who am I becoming? And who do I want to be? That first question is where the rubber hits the road. It speaks to your identity. Have you accepted Christ as your Savior? If you have not, let today be your day where a decisive moment takes place, a defining moment. Pray with me these words. Heavenly Father, I need you. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Wash away my sins. Let today be the beginning of my new identity. I ask you this in Christ's name. Amen. Congratulations. If you just prayed with me, we'd love to put some information into your hands that'll help anchor your decision of becoming born again and letting you know how to grow in this relationship with Jesus Christ. But certainly, as we grow together as a family, don't miss out on these next 2 weeks as I talk about character and integrity. God bless you. Have a great week.